Thank you, everyone. Good morning. It is absolutely a pleasure to be here. It's wonderful to be in Russia. It was wonderful to be in St. Petersburg. I want to thank the Russian Society of Gynecologic Oncology for the invitation, Dr. Elena Ulrich and Dr. Igor Brevlev for the invitation as well. And I want to thank all of you for attending this presentation. The goal of the presentation today will be, hopefully we'll be able to remove that from the center. The goal of the presentation today will be to address some of the issues related to the recently published study comparing open versus minimally invasive radical hysterectomy. Over the course of the next 20-25 minutes, I will speak about not only the results of the study, but as you know, there were many points that have been brought up in innumerable editorials that have been published since the publication of the study that hopefully I'll be able to address. And in addition to that, since the study has come out, there have been a number of additional studies that have confirmed the results of the LAC trial, so hopefully I will be able to discuss that as well. And at the end, I will welcome any additional questions that you might have after we complete the session in the morning. So as I mentioned, this was a prospective randomized trial comparing open versus minimally invasive radical hysterectomies in patients with early stage cervical cancer. The primary objective of the trial was to evaluate disease-free survival at 4.5 years between the two arms of the trial, between open and minimally invasive surgery. And I should highlight that this was not a trial looking at open versus laparoscopy versus robotics. This was a trial looking at open versus minimally invasive surgery. And when patients were randomized to the minimally invasive approach, then the surgeon could select whether the patient was undergoing a laparoscopy or a robotics approach. The trial began in June of 2008, and the total goal of the trial was to accrue a total of 740 patients. When we were notified in June of 2017, we had accrued a total of 631 patients. We were notified by the Data Safety Monitoring Committee that at this point, after accruing 631 patients, that there was a safety issue with one of the arms. Because they could not recommend on closure of the study at that point, and they wanted to get additional follow-up data, they could not tell us what the issue was or in which arm. So at that point, we collected additional follow-up information, and 4 months later, a reanalysis of the data was performed. When the reanalysis of the data was performed, the Data Safety Monitoring Committee, at that point, after 631 patients had been randomized, then made the recommendation that we should close the study. And we should close the study because we had already answered the proposed question of the study. In other words, there were already an increased number of recurrences in the minimally invasive arm. In fact, 4 times higher rate of recurrence in the minimally invasive surgery arm, and the mortality rate was 6 times higher in minimally invasive radical hysterectomy. So therefore, at that point, the Data Safety Monitoring Committee made a recommendation that it was no longer ethical to continue accruing patients onto the trial. When we closed the trial, there were 312 patients that had been randomized to the open surgery arm and 319 patients that were randomized to the minimally invasive surgery arm. When looking at the patients who were randomized, when we evaluated patients who had open surgery, randomized to open surgery, 88% of those patients who were randomized to open surgery actually had open surgery. 91% of the patients that were randomized to minimally invasive surgery actually had minimally invasive surgery. 6% and 4% of patients, respectively, were withdrawn prior to the surgery. In terms of surgery being abandoned, reasons for abandoning surgery typically were if there was evidence of positive lymph nodes or if there was evidence of disease outside of the cervix or uterus, then the surgery was abandoned. 4% in the open arm, 5% in the minimally invasive arm. In terms of the patients that were lost to follow-up, in fact, actually that rate was quite low, 6% in the open surgery arm and 4% in the minimally invasive arm. And these rates are very consistent with multiple prospective randomized trials. When looking at patients who underwent minimally invasive surgery, the question was also how many patients underwent laparoscopy and how many patients underwent robotic surgery. The overwhelming majority of patients in the LAC trial had laparoscopic surgery. As you see, 84% had laparoscopic surgery and 16% had robotic surgery. And this was important because when the results of the LAC trial were presented in the United States, one of the claims was that in the United States, most radical hysterectomies are performed by robotics, not laparoscopy. So many surgeons felt that the results of the LAC trial did not really reflect the practice of the United States. But certainly I'll speak about that in a second, as there was another study that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, and we will talk about the distribution of robotic surgery versus laparoscopic surgery in that trial. When looking at the conversion rate, 3% of patients were converted from minimally invasive surgery to laparotomy, and certainly this is very consistent with what we knew from retrospective data. At the time that we published the LAC trial, we had 60% of information available at 4.5 years. And at that point, when the Data Safety Monitoring Committee alerted us to the fact that we had to close the trial, there was obviously a significant difference between the minimally invasive surgery and the open surgery group, hazard ratio almost of 4, meaning that the recurrence rate was 4 times higher for patients undergoing laparoscopic or robotic radical hysterectomy. Recurrence rate was 4 times higher in that group. We were asked a year after the study was published, in other words, the study was published in 2018, and at that point, we had mentioned again that the data completion was 60% at 4.5 years. So the Society of Gynecologic Oncology asked us 1 year later to reevaluate the data, to redo the calculations, and to see if the results were still consistent. So this is the data that was presented at the SGO meeting in Hawaii this year in 2019. And as you see here, at this point, we already had 76% of information available at 4.5 years for our patients. And when we looked at the disease-free survival in those patients, we saw that it was exactly the same hazard ratio. In other words, 9 recurrences in the open surgery group and 36 recurrences in the minimally invasive group. Again, 4 times higher recurrence rate in minimally invasive surgery as opposed to open surgery. We then also evaluated the disease-free survival in the intent-to-treat population and the per-protocol population. And again, the findings were very consistent that the minimally invasive surgery arm was significantly worse in disease-free survival at 4.5 years, with a disease-free survival of 96% in open surgery and 84% in minimally invasive surgery. We had also looked at the overall survival, and again, let me remind you, overall survival was not the primary objective. Overall survival was one of the secondary objectives. So we evaluated also the overall survival, and at that time, again, the overall survival was significantly worse for patients undergoing radical hysterectomy through a minimally invasive approach. And this was once again confirmed when the data was presented 1 year later. The overall survival was worse for minimally invasive surgery. In the same issue of the New England Journal of Medicine in October of 2018, another group was evaluating the same question, but this was not a prospective randomized trial. This was a study evaluating the National Cancer Registry database in the United States. This was a trial again asking the question of open surgery versus minimally invasive radical hysterectomy, looking specifically at cancer-related outcomes. And what they found, again, with over 1,000 patients in each arm, was that minimally invasive surgery was associated with a worse survival compared to open surgery. And as we go back now to the point of the distribution of laparoscopy and robotics, you may remember that in the LAC trial, 84% of patients had laparoscopy and 16% of patients had robotic surgery. In this trial was exactly the opposite. In this trial, 88% of patients had a robotic radical hysterectomy and 12% of patients had a laparoscopic radical hysterectomy. In other words, demonstrating that the findings were also consistent if the majority of patients were undergoing robotic radical hysterectomy. Minimally invasive radical hysterectomy was associated with a worse survival. One of the other things that the investigators did was, because this is a national cancer registry database, they can evaluate when the United States started doing radical hysterectomy through the robotics approach. And in the United States, the robotics approach was approved in 2006. So one of the questions that the investigators said, well, what happens to the survival of patients with early cervical cancer before robotic surgery and after robotic surgery is introduced in the United States? And as you see here, this is the breakdown of 2006. This is the number of radical hysterectomies performed in the United States after 2006. The overwhelming majority of radical hysterectomies in the United States after 2006 were being performed by robotics approach. This is the survival of patients with early cervical cancer, stage 1A2, stage 1B1, prior to 2006. And what the investigators noted, that coincidentally with the introduction of robotic radical hysterectomy, there was a decline in the survival of patients with early cervical cancer. So therefore, again, suggesting that the minimally invasive approach was impacting the survival of patients adversely and therefore causing an increasing risk of recurrences. So since the publication of these two studies, there have been a number of editorials that have been written about particularly the LAC trial. Till today, there's actually 14 editorials that have been written. Interestingly, many of those editorials were written even before the paper was published. So a lot of those editorials were written when not all of the data had been presented. But what I wish to address in the next session of this presentation is some of the points that have been brought up in those editorials. And certainly would love to address any additional questions that you might have that is not covered by these points of discussion. One of the first points was, well, the LAC trial did not have data completion because there was a lot of data missing. And it was reported that in up to 30% of patients, the data was missing on death of invasion. And up to 30% of patients, the data was missing on grade of invasion. But one of the things that I would point out is that when these editorials were written, certainly one of the things that we need to highlight is that the manuscript had not been published. These were editorials that were written only on the SGO presentation. In addition to that, one needs to also look at the title of the slide. If you look at the title of that slide, it's postoperative histopathology, meaning 21% of patients in both groups had no residual disease, meaning the hysterectomy specimen had no residual disease. So if you have no residual disease, that specimen has no grade. If you have no residual disease, that specimen has no death of invasion. So therefore, that's why you'll see the 30% and the 33%, because this is reflecting the fact that 21% of patients had no residual disease. It was claimed that there was also a lot of information missing with regards to tumor size, lymphvascular invasion, parametrial involvement of vaginal margins. These range anywhere from 5%, 6%, up to 10%. The amount of data missing in any prospective randomized trial ranges anywhere from 7% to 10%, particularly when that prospective randomized trial involves multiple sites. So this amount of missing information, 5 to 7%, 10%, is very consistent with what is seen in prospective randomized trials. The other question that has been brought up is the number of patients per site. one of the editorials said, well, you know, the number of patients that were involved in the LAC trial is very low, because if one does the mathematics and the calculation, it only comes up to 2 patients per year per center, raising the question whether all surgeons had the chance to maintain sufficient experience. This type of calculation is very inaccurate and very incorrect, and I would urge everyone, when looking at prospective randomized trials, don't assume that the number of cases per center is based on the number of total patients divided by the number of centers divided by the number of years. So in other words, how do they come up with this 2 patients per year? There were 319 patients in the minimally invasive arm. If you divide 319 by 33, there were 33 centers, and then you divide that by 9, which was the number of years that it took for the study, you come up with 2 patients per year. But obviously, that is not very accurate calculation, because in any prospective randomized trial, this is the typical accrual for a prospective randomized trial. Not every center accrues the same number of patients. Not every center starts accruing at the same time. So of the 33 centers for the LAC trial, 71% of patients were accrued in 14 centers. So you cannot make the assumption of, again, calculating the number of patients per year based on the total number divided by the total centers divided by the total number of years. That is very premature thinking and not very accurate. The other question that has come up is recurrence per site. And they say, well, most of the recurrence happened in 14 centers. So there must have been a problem with the surgery in those 14 centers. Again, in a prospective randomized trial, the events, be it recurrence, be it mortality, be it complications, are going to occur in the centers that are accruing patients. So therefore, those centers accrued 71% of patients, so therefore, that's where the recurrences are going to show up. That's where the complications are going to show up. It's not because there were issues of skills with the surgeons in those centers, it's just that's where the patients were being accrued. Similar to the case of a surgeon that does 500 cases a year versus a surgeon that does 3 cases a year, the surgeon that does 500 cases a year most likely will have a higher complication rate because that's the surgeon that's doing the most surgeries. So again, it's the same calculation. One of the other elements has been, well, the LAC trial didn't really tell us if it is safe to do minimally invasive surgery in patients with small tumors, less than 2 centimeters. And we have to be very careful because one of the interpretations of the LAC trial has been the recurrence rate in low-risk patients was very low. So therefore, it is okay to continue doing minimally invasive surgery in low-risk patients, patients with less than 2 centimeters. We have to highlight this, and our statisticians, again, advise us to highlight that this trial was not designed to compare patients in low-risk groups. This trial was not powered to compare patients in low-risk groups because in the low-risk patient population, the recurrence rate is extremely low. So when you have a recurrence rate, an event that the recurrence is so low, you would need significantly more numbers of patients to see a difference between the open and the minimally invasive arm. So if you see here, in the less than 2 centimeters, there was 1 recurrence in 147 patients in the open group. There was 5 recurrences in 150 patients in the minimally invasive group. Conversely, one might say, yes, well, those numbers are very low. Those recurrence rates are very low, and I'm comfortable operating on a patient when the recurrence rate is 0.6%. Remember, again, not powered. The concerning issue is that in the minimally invasive surgery arm, recurrence rate was 5 times higher than in the open surgery group, leading one to wonder if the power was enough. In other words, if the study had thousands of patients, would we have seen the same thing? One of the other issues was, well, it's not that the minimally invasive surgery arm did so poorly in the LAC trial. is that the open arm did so much better, and that's why you're seeing a disadvantage to the minimally invasive group. And one of the things that has been mentioned is that in the minimally invasive group, the results, as you see here, disease-free survival is 84%, but in the open surgery group, the disease-free survival is 96%. And again, claiming that 96% is too good, so that we would expect 80% survival rates in those patients. And let me just go back and tell you that in the meta-analyses that have been published on minimally invasive surgery, when you look at the open surgery arm, the disease-free survival has been very similar to the 96% that was shown in the LAC trial, 93%, 94%, 94.4%. The other thing is also is that when looking at this 80% survival rate, because one of the claims that has been made is we should anticipate 80% survival rate in open surgery, because that's what we know from the GOG trials. There are three trials from the GOG that's where we get this 80% survival rate in patients undergoing open radical surgery. One of them is a trial that was 30 years ago, so certainly the patterns of practice were very different. The other two were trials that operated on patients, and inclusion criteria, you had to have positive lymph nodes, or you had to have positive perimetrium, or you had to have tumors that were more than 4 centimeters. That's a very different population than the LAC trial population. So of course, in a patient with positive lymph nodes, positive perimetrium, and positive vaginal margins, one would anticipate an 80 or 85% recurrence rate or disease-free survival, but certainly in the LAC trial, that's not the patient population that we saw. So it is very consistent for us to see disease-free survival of over 95%. The other issue was, well, the LAC trial didn't tell us about the difference between laparoscopy or robotic surgery results. Again, let me remind you, the LAC trial was not designed to compare laparoscopy versus robotic. It was designed to compare open versus minimally invasive surgery. So therefore, one cannot claim a fault on the trial where that trial never intended to answer that question. One of the other issues has been, well, we don't know if the surgeons used a uterine manipulator or how the colpotomy was performed. We have this information in the LAC trial. Why did we not report it? We didn't report it because it was not the information that was needed to answer the primary objective nor the secondary objective. So therefore, that was not reported in that manuscript. Do we have information about whether a manipulator was used? Yes, we have 631 operative reports. Of those, 319 were minimally invasive surgery. We can look at those 319 operative reports and determine if there was a uterine manipulator used or not. Lastly, the early stopping of the trial. This has been a criticism of the trial. They say, well, we cannot find validity in a trial that hasn't accrued what it meant to accrue. Very different in a trial that the Data Safety Monitoring Committee at the LAC trial tells you, you have to stop because patients are dying. You have to stop because recurrence rates are higher. That's a very different reason for a stopping rule than when a trial stops just because you can't accrue patients, the patients are not coming, the question is no longer interesting. That's very, very different. We had to stop the trial because the Data Safety Monitoring Committee and the statisticians in the Data Safety Monitoring Committee said, you already have your answer. There's a higher risk of recurrences, and therefore, you have to stop. I would mention also that, obviously, there are a number of surgeons that are saying, well, that may be the case for this trial. That may be the case for the National Registry Database. But in my practice, I don't see that. In my hospital, we don't see that. So therefore, we're going to keep going. We don't have time, obviously, to go through this manuscript, but this is an excellent manuscript when surgeons will say, look, I looked at my experience and I don't see it. This is an excellent article that was published in The Lancet in 2013, looking at individual surgeons. In other words, when surgeons say, in my practice, in my numbers, it's okay, so therefore I can continue. It explains why you can't do that. A surgeon is exceedingly unlikely to have enough number of cases themselves to have enough power to answer a study question. It would be exceedingly unlikely. So therefore, they say we recommend avoiding the interpretation of no evidence of poor performance as evidence of acceptable performance. Again, very, very interesting article. When we published this, obviously there was a tremendous amount of interest, not only from the media. We had a lot of interviews from the media about the results of this finding. In the United States, it is information that most patients are extremely aware of this information. It is actually now patients asking us to make sure that we don't do the surgery by minimally invasive surgery because they are aware of these results. So certainly there has been quite a significant dissemination. There's also been claims that say, well, you know, maybe that's a problem with American surgeons. And of course the American surgeons say, well, that's a problem with other surgeons outside of the United States. Nevertheless, other countries have looked and explored this question. This is a recent publication from the British Gynecologic Cancer Society. In the United Kingdom, the surgeons requested of their society, and they said, let's look at our numbers, because we don't see that in our practices. So therefore, it must be an issue that it was only in Latin America, it was only in the United States, not in the UK. So when they saw the results, the results in the United Kingdom again showed that minimally invasive surgery was worse than open surgery when looking at disease-free survival. A large group in Korea. In the Korean group, they say, well, let's explore our own data, and again, let's see what the results are. And they, again, found that minimally invasive radical hysterectomy was associated with higher recurrence rates. So again, it's the LAC trial. Is the National Cancer Registry database, both published in the New England Journal of Medicine, the British Gynecologic Cancer Society, the Korean groups showing the same findings, and as you see here, worse survival. A group in the United States that claims to have very high volume of surgery, particularly in robotic surgery, they said, we're gonna look at our own data. In the United States, high volume surgeons. And what they found, again, was the robotic radical hysterectomy had a significantly worse survival than the open radical hysterectomy in the patients also looking at overall survival. When we presented this data at the SGO, there were a group of surgeons from multiple institutions in the United States and Canada that said, that doesn't reflect us. Let's look at our own institutions. 8 institutions, high volume, very experienced surgeons in the United States, and they said, in a year from now, we're going to have this data, and we're going to show that if this is done by experienced surgeons, if this is done in high volume surgeons, then this is not going to be the case. So this data was presented at the ASCO meeting earlier this month in Chicago by Chitanso Upal, and they actually formed a group that was called Trust But Verify Study Group. And they again looked at these sites that are high volume, high experienced surgeons. And what they found when they did their evaluation of patients undergoing minimally invasive, usually robotic radical hysterectomy versus open, was that the recurrence rate was again higher in the minimally invasive group compared to the open group. In fact, this recurrence rate is significantly higher than the recurrence rate in the minimally invasive group in the LAC trial, which was 8%. This is the survival curves that they showed, again, in those high volume centers as well, showing that there was a disadvantage to minimally invasive surgery. So again, a prospective randomized trial from around the world, a large database registry, the United Kingdom, Korea, high volume centers in the United States and Canada, all saying the same thing, that minimally invasive surgery was worse than open radical hysterectomy. This led to the recommendation from the ESGO Society recommending the updated recommendation saying the open approach is the gold standard for radical hysterectomy. Now in the United States, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network, or also known as the NCCN guidelines, there's going to be a change, also suggesting that the new standards should be open radical hysterectomy. We had the great fortune that at the completion of 2018, the New England Journal of Medicine chooses 12 articles that they consider have changed medicine in the last year. And the LAC trial was chosen as one of those articles. So we are obviously extremely proud of these results. I want to thank my friends Fred Amont and Murat. It's been a fantastic opportunity here in Russia, and along with Elena and the group, we have had a great time. I also want to thank Dr. Sophia Michelson. She's with the American Euro-Asian Cancer Alliance for hosting us in Moscow as well. And again, I want to thank all of you. This is the journal, the International Gynecologic Cancer Journal. We encourage all of you to send your submissions. We actually have left a few copies of the journal that are actually unique copies because the journal is not printed, but we brought them here for the meeting in Russia, and I'll be happy to answer any questions at the end of the session. Thank you very much.